My favourite show of the past is probably Breaking Bad, which I thought was the most riveting drama series I've ever watched. Mm-hmm. My favourite show at the moment, or at least of this year, is The Bureau, which, if those of you who haven't seen it, you can see it on Amazon Prime. And when you leave here, you'll probably forget everything that was said, but if you just remember that The Bureau is available on Amazon Prime, you'll think, well, that was a good evening, that was worthwhile. And as for a future program, well, I was lucky enough to see a preview this week of the drama that the BBC is launching on New Year's Day, McMafia, this week, which is inspired by a friend of mine, Misha Glenny's book on organized crime. And it looks amazing. I mean, the opening episode was almost as good as The Bureau.
You wrote a book about Channel 4, which got you a job at the BBC. Not the most obvious route in. You then spent just 3 months in the governance and management department before it was a case of, I'm a wannabe producer, get me to the docs department, where you spent the next 16 years. So what were your highlights during that time?
Well, it was an unusual way in. Joining the secretariat of the BBC is not the way you think you're going to get into making documentaries. But I was very lucky. I met somebody who ran one of the documentary strands at the BBC at a meeting, and he happened to be looking for a researcher. And somehow I managed to persuade him that it would be a good idea to take a bet on me. And my highlights, well, what was brilliant about those days in the BBC documentaries department is that we had an enormous amount of freedom to go and make documentaries about things that we were interested in. We had a lot of delegated commissioning. When I started at the BBC, the controllers would send us a list and they would say, we want 3 landmark series, 4 popular documentary series, 2 docu-soaps, and a couple of whatever. And it was up to us to choose what programs we wanted to make. Well, that's a long way away.
The good old days.
Everything is now obviously controlled by the controllers and by the people at the center. But I, as a documentary maker on some of the strands, there was a very well-known strand in those days called 40 Minutes, which was on BBC Two. And then there was another one on BBC One called Inside Story. I had an amazing amount of freedom to go off and make documentaries about things that I was interested in. By and large, I was almost self-commissioning, which was fantastic. I mean, I had some very good editors at the strands who would be those people that would ask difficult questions, and it was those questions that made you confront the things that often you were kind of ignoring. And it's a lesson that I learned, and that's what I try and do now with the people that I work with, is give them a lot of autonomy, but at the same time, just ask those questions that make them think about whether what they're doing is going to work. I often found, actually, making documentaries that it's only when you have to explain what you're doing that you work out what it is that's interesting. Sometimes I thought I was making a documentary about one thing, but then when I was at a dinner party or somewhere and I was having to explain what I was doing, it was the act of trying to interest people and hold the room that would force you to suddenly grab this and this and that, and you realize that was what your documentary was about, as opposed to what you thought it was. And then you had to remember that and try and make sure that you actually did that. But it was great, because I was particularly interested in telling the sort of human story behind people in situations very often of conflict. The first few documentaries I made were in Northern Ireland in the 80s. We did a very controversial one when I was still an assistant producer about Martin McGuinness that was actually led to a constitutional crisis between the Board of Management and the Board of Governors. The Board of Management thought it should go out, and the Board of Governors said it shouldn't. And the BBC went on strike. In fact, it was the only time that the World Service has come off air and played music. In fact, there was a famous cartoon at the time in The Guardian with a couple on holiday listening to martial music, and they thought music on the World Service, and they were speculating as to whether there'd been a coup in Britain. Then I went on to make lots of other documentaries in quite difficult areas, with the Tamil Tigers, or with the South African riot police just after Mandela was released, or in Kuwait after the first Gulf War, or in Gaza during the first Intifada, And we've got a clip here which we could play, from a film. But you're going to tell me you found a description of it somewhere.
I did, so I had to do some digging around, because it's quite an old one, isn't it? So this isn't freely available on Amazon Prime, sadly. It should be. Basically, this is a motley collection of thrill seekers and borderline sociopaths, mediocre people from mediocre places in mediocre times, who have sought out an extraordinary situation in pursuit of the buzz of death. Wow. I think we have to see this.
Reports from Croatia say there's been renewed shelling of the eastern town of Osijek. At least 5 people were killed when the town was bombarded overnight. Reuters news agency quoted Croatian police as saying that hundreds of shells and rockets had been fired from positions occupied by the Serbian-dominated Federal Army and Serb irregulars. The Croatian authorities said this was the worst ceasefire violation since the beginning of January, when the current truce came into force.
I've always wanted to kill legally, you know, have that feeling, you know, take people out. I mean, I've always wondered what we're going through, like Yorkshire Ripper, Black Panther's mind, you know, I mean, what, these had no compassion, they had no feeling. I want this feeling. It's like an higher than any drug can get you, I think.
Everybody thinks, you know, being a mercenary, and that's great fun. Half the time, you don't get frigging paid. You know, so I think a lot of the time, you're doing it for the buzz. Because we don't make good civilians. It's a known fact. We are not good civilians. You know, we're forever breaking laws. Maybe it's just for the buzz and for the chase and for the excitement.
I don't believe in the Croatian cause. That's for them to believe in that. I only came down here for something to do. So just keep me out of trouble. Stop me from hanging around those street corners.
First 3 men, go!
The bloody Yugoslavian civil war has become a magnet for many men attracted to violence. Not since the Spanish Civil War have so many foreigners signed up for another country's cause. The pay is poor. These men, members of the only English-speaking company in the Croatian army, earn £100 a month. Nevertheless, hundreds of foreigners have come, many of them from Britain.
Wow. So, an incredible body of work during that period, and as you mentioned, some of those strands, Modern Times and Inside Story, I remember watching those and, you know, amazing docs. So you did that for around another 5 years, and then you decided to leave the BBC. So what was the catalyst?
Well, after being a documentary maker and going out into the world, I became the editor of Modern Times, which was the main documentary strand on BBC Two in the 90s. So I started counting them all out and counting them all back, as opposed to actually seeing the world. But it was fascinating to have that responsibility to commission. And as I was saying, people could come in to my office and pitch an idea, and I had the freedom to be able to commission it there and then, which is something that doesn't really exist anymore. And then I started coming up with ideas for other shows, docu-soaps and all kinds of different series. And that was great. We would start selling other programs, but it didn't actually reflect in one's pay packet. And lots of other people that I was working with at the BBC started leaving and setting up independent production companies. And it was the time of John Burt, and it felt like the power that we had and the autonomy that we had was disappearing. So I commissioned a small company called RDF to make a documentary for Modern Times, and got to know David Frank, who was running the company, and he wanted a creative head of the company, and we got on very well, and so I joined him, and then discovered that the cold, brutal world of commercial television, being an independent, meant that you couldn't really build a business on single documentaries. So we had to come up with repeatable programs, But I didn't really know how to do repeatable programmes. I, at the BBC, was very interested in single documentaries. So I said this to my wife one night, and she said, flash of inspiration, why don't you do Pygmalion for real? And I said, oh, that's a good idea. And I sent an email to my friend Peter Dale, who I'd worked with at the BBC and who was now head of documentaries at Channel 4. And again, in those days, rather than having to write hundreds of treatments and lots of pieces of paper and kind of work out what your horse was and you end up with a camel, I got an email back from him saying, what a brilliant idea, let's do a pilot. And we made a pilot, and it was Faking It. And Faking It was the first documentary format I made. And I was able to persuade a lot of great documentary makers to come and work on it because, A, I'd been working with them at the BBC and had a great relationship with them. But also I was able to persuade them that, you know, that frustrating thing you have when you try to make an Access documentary and you've got to try and find the beginning, middle and end, and you've got to get access to it, and you've got to hope that the beginning, middle and end happens within the kind of time period that you can have for a documentary. Well, you don't have to have any of that with a format. We will create the situation and we'll give these people a month to learn a skill and try and convince a panel of judges that, we'll give them the challenge of whether they can spot the fake. And it worked. We got some amazingly good documentary makers and the programs were more than just the kind of routine format, and it won BAFTA 2 years in a row and was probably the most loved program I've ever made.
And it was there ever a part of you that felt, you know, that sort of more constructed style of doc with, you know, a very neat beginning, middle and end, you know, taking you away from that purist doc stuff you were doing at the BBC? Do you ever for a minute think it was selling out or you're just concentrating on cashing in?
what a nicely put question. I mean, obviously, if you are running an independent production company, it's quite difficult to be purist and just make single documentaries. We still did a lot of single documentaries. I carried on working with one of the best documentary makers around, Adam Curtis, and made several programs with him. Funnily enough, I was actually given, in a rather weird arrangement, the responsibility for commissioning a single documentary strand on ITV while working for RDF, but I couldn't commission RDF. So it wasn't like I completely abandoned my interest in sort of heavyweight documentary. But in the end, if you're trying to run a business, and David and I wanted to create a company of value, we wanted to, in the end, we floated it on the stock market. So you certainly can't float companies on the stock market on single documentaries.
Mm. And so, you know, Wife Swap and Faking It, both incredibly successful formats. And how would you sum up their impact on the global market? And did you ever anticipate that level of success? Did you sort of sit there and think, we're going to, you know, conquer 100 territories? And
well, no, you never know quite what's going to be a hit. I mean, you can tell usually what's going to be a hit once you are in the cutting room and you can sense a real excitement as people start watching it. And certainly when you start putting a program out, the reactions you get, I mean, in those days it was probably a bit pre-Twitter, certainly with something like Gogglebox, which started small, the Twitter reaction was so strong that you realized that we were onto something. Mm-hmm. If a show works here, then there's a good chance it will work in the rest of the world. But the key for us, and has always been, whether it's at RDF or now at Studio Lambert, is coming up with ideas here that we can also make in America. And the great advantage that we have as British producers in competition with the American producers is that when we go to America, we can show them tape of our idea, whereas their ideas, they might be very good, but they haven't got any tape. They have to either film something themselves, but that's very expensive, or they have to rip something off the internet to try to illustrate what they're trying to sell and envisage their idea. Whereas we can say, look, we've made it, and we can show them a little tape, and when they look at it, they immediately understand it, and that's a great benefit. So with Wife Swap, we showed ABC what the idea was, and they went for it. And it worked. And it was quite unusual to make those kind of formatted documentaries on broadcast television in America, because in sort of until about 2000, broadcast television in America, as opposed to cable, didn't really have anything that was unscripted. Everything was either drama or comedy or news. Then in 2000, or around that period, two enormous shows were launched, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire and Survivor. And they transformed American broadcast television. They became these monster hits. And the whole unscripted business on broadcast television took off. But all those shows were competition serial reality shows. They were ones where you were waiting to see who would win a competition, and they weren't closed episodes. What was unusual about Wife Swap, and Wife Swap was followed on ABC about the same time by Super Nanny, was that you had two shows that were closed episode on a broadcast network. And that was a bold step for them to do, because they were quite conservative about what they thought would work. And they believed that you needed continuity of character, the same face each week, to be able to hold an audience. So to have a different cast each week was something that they were skeptical about, but they thought the format, certainly in the case of Wife Swap, was so strong that they were willing to give it a go. Now, the great thing about closed episodes is that you can repeat them, and they loved it. Once it started working, they could repeat it, and they loved the fact that you could also sell those episodes to cable or to when they came along, Netflix and other streamers. So they had a lot of value in a way that a competition reality show like Survivor doesn't get repeated anywhere. Neither does American Idol. I mean, they're hugely valuable shows, but they don't have that repeatable value that a closed episode show has.
Mm. And as you said, so RDF was a tiny company when you first were working with them, and you know, largely thanks to you, you know, with these incredible formats, it floated, it became hugely successful. You were rewarded with becoming head of the group at RDF. But I think, like as a lot of creatives and producers talk about, that move away from, you know, being on the shop floor and being creative was something that you weren't that comfortable with, being sort of disconnected from storytelling. Is that the reason that you then decided to leave RDF?
Well, it's certainly one of the main reasons. We did get bigger, and we started buying other companies, and I became the, whatever my title was, chief creative officer of the group, which is quite a difficult title to have in any group of production companies, because it's never quite clear what that job is. Because you're not the buyer, but equally, if you start telling everybody what ideas they should be selling, that doesn't really work. So my wife said, you don't seem to be getting out of bed with the same spring in your step. And I then decided to start my own company and got talking to All Three Media, and I would talk to other companies that were interested in backing a new startup. But All Three Media was the most attractive because, ultimately, because of its federal model. It is the extreme version of the group that allows the companies within it to have their own culture, and that was something I craved, while at the same time giving a lot of support in terms of a great distribution company and all kinds of other support that the group is able to give us. But it's not something that tries to meld companies together, which a lot of other groups do. I mean, a lot of groups think, oh, well, let's bring all our creatives together and they can all brainstorm. Well, that doesn't really work. It's better to have these companies with their own individual cultures and their own individual creative drives. So we launched Studio Lambert, as you say, about 10 years ago. It wasn't a great time to launch. It was 2008. It was a financial crisis. Channel 4 and ITV saw a big slash in their program budgets. And initially, it didn't seem very easy to get shows away. We struggled to get Undercover Boss commissioned, which was an idea that we had. There was all kinds of problems in getting it away. But eventually, we made two episodes. We were meant to make a third episode, but the company we were going to film went out of business about 3 days before we started shooting. But nevertheless, that first two episodes, we were able to cut a sizzle tape, which is what we call those tapes that you take to America. And we took a sizzle tape of it to CBS. And remarkably, we were able to pitch it to the top person, the president of CBS, and she loved it. And she ordered a pilot. And the pilot was a struggle to make, but it was good, and it was about the man who ran America's largest waste management company, and he went undercover to find out what it was like on the front lines. And it was emotional and fun, and it was different to anything that CBS had had before. And they tested it. And they have a huge facility in Las Vegas with 2,500 people who watch all their pilots. And the test results came back, and they said, oh, no, that can't be right. Send it back again. We need proper results. This is far too good. It can't be right. So they sent it back again, and the results were even better the second time. So they decided to not only order the series, but to launch it in the slot after the Super Bowl, which is a pretty good place to launch your show if you're launching a show on American television. It means that we inherited, well, the Super Bowl got 100 million viewers. They then have a post-game analysis show, so the audience fell to about 45 million, which is what we inherited. And then we managed to hold that pretty much. We averaged 38 million viewers for the first episode. So I then went back to everybody and said, I've worked it out. In future, we only launch our shows in the slot after the Super Bowl. And the show turned out to be the most popular new show in any genre on broadcast television that year, which was remarkable. And continues. We're about to launch the 9th season. But now we have tried to reinvent it. And at the end of last season, we did two episodes that are a rather different show, actually. We had it as a separate idea, and we were about to pitch it to others. But then we decided, oh, no, actually, it's something we could do as a sort of alternative show to Undercover Boss. It's called Celebrity Undercover. And instead of bosses going undercover to find out what's going on in their businesses, we have celebrities looking for undiscovered talent in their field, but they go in disguise because they want to find out what these people are really like. They want to see whether they deserve the kind of support that they might be able to give them. And so next season, which is going to happen next year, is all celebrities. But we can show you
We've got a great clip. Yeah, let's have a look.
Have you ever made a dough before?
No.
Oh my God.
Sorry.
Ladies and gentlemen, Hootie and the Blowfish. Nowhere to
follow. There was a moment when we were the biggest band in the world.
Dish looks great.
Jacqueline. Thank you.
Music business is hard. For every person like me, there is 500,000 people that never make it.
I know what it is to be in a homeless shelter, and with the right plate, you can ease anybody's soul.
I stopped dreaming a long time ago, man. What I truly want to do is connect with people.
It is too good. They're not going to recognize me.
I'm going undercover because I don't want anyone to treat me differently just because I'm Darius Rucker.
You're too good to give up.
That means a lot. It really does.
They got what they need to make it. They just need to learn some things.
She just needs a little help, and she's going to be a star.
Jackie Middleton, man.
Jackie Middleton, that's an awesome name.
Do you want a piece?
No, I'm fine, thank you.
You fine?
Give me a sec, give me a sec.
Now, I'm really gonna show them who I am.
Hey.
I know you.
Seen you on TV.
Wait a second, I recognize you.
Sounded 100% like Darius Rucker.
To be able to share your music with the world.
So I'm going to connect you with a branding expert.
My goal is to get you a record deal to make you a superstar.
I would like to send you to culinary school, all expenses paid for.
Wow.
You have to be kidding.
This is a big life-changing day for me.
Little old hood girl got a big old opportunity.
Oh, looks fantastic. And I love the sort of the warmth that you've sort of generated in these shows and the kind of emotion. And that's, you know, sort of quite interesting, the sort of key to the success. And I guess, you know, in the current climate that we kind of need some of this, don't we? And also just the way that you continue to evolve the formats that have been the key to your success. I mean, just going back to Undercover Boss, was that really the thing that did it for you in the same way as Wife? So it's incredible to have that success very early on, but then also to look at how you keep evolving. What sort of proportion of your, you know, development time is sort of looking at, you know, your existing formats as opposed to your original? How do you actually structure your development team?
Well, our development team concentrates on new ideas, by and large. If we're making a show and we're trying to keep it fresh, that usually comes from the team that are making that show. They're keen to find ways of keeping a show fresh, and I talk to them about it. But our development team are brilliant at coming up with ideas and getting them to the point where we can pitch them to broadcasters all over the place.
Mm. And how involved are you in that? How hands-on are you?
I'm pretty hands-on. I mean, I used to be much more hands-on. We now have a fantastic creative director, Tim Harcourt, who's full of great ideas. We now have a drama department, and Sue Hogg, who runs it, is very good at coming up with ideas or talking to writers and finding people who've got ideas or optioning books. We have a team in America who are coming up with ideas as well as making American versions of our British shows. So those three bits of the company, as it were, are the people that I'm talking to all the time. And sometimes I get very involved in the development of an idea. Today we were doing a run-through for a new game show that we're making, which is actually unusual for us. It was an idea that Richard Bacon gave to us. Normally we create all our ideas ourselves, but he came and told me about this idea and I thought it was brilliant. And that's an idea that I've got very close to, and we're doing a run-through. Quite interesting, actually. We're doing a run-through on Friday for lots of different buyers from the UK to come and watch it.
That's
unusual because
that's
in Britain...
That's more an American model, isn't
exactly,
it?
Exactly. Mm. There's a big difference between Britain and America in terms of selling an idea. In Britain, we tend to go to broadcasters with an idea, often a half-baked idea, and we kind of persuade them to engage, and we sort of work on it together. The minute they engage and get interested, obviously you can't take it to any of their competitors because, well, that's not playing the game. In America, it's the very opposite. In America, they expect you to come to them with quite a well-worked-out idea. It always has to have some take, which goes back to my point about why we British producers have this big advantage. But you're meant to expose it to everybody. In fact, it's rude if you don't offer it to all the competitors. If you sell an idea to an American broadcaster and it's a hit and their rival hasn't had a chance to bid on it, they ring you up and say, or they ring your agents up and say, what the hell happened there? So it's quite a different market to the British market.
So how did you persuade the Brits to
play
ball with
Well, game shows are slightly different. If you do a run-through of a show, it's quite a big event, and entertainment has got a slightly different... Entertainment, because it's more used to the idea of these big formats, there is a bit more of a tradition in this country of exposing an idea or offering an idea... Exposing is a very American term. Offering an idea to multiple buyers at once. It's certainly something that, as a producer, if you've got a good idea, is great, because obviously if they all like your idea, or even just two of them like your idea, then they will bid the price up. The challenge is, of course, that you can't kind of develop it with them. They don't sort of feel that quite that same sense of creating it with you, and that's the slight, and you need to have the idea really worked out. You can't pitch them, you can't pitch to lots of them all at once something that you haven't really worked out what it is, because well, that looks terrible.
So that's the thing that sort of still motivates you then is the get it, you know, having the conversations with Richard Bacon or talent who actually seem increasingly to be involved in ideas, I think. Is that really sort of what drives you? And in fact, it makes me wonder, fascinated to know, undercover boss, what kind of boss are you? You know, would you let the cameras in?
Well, of course, I'd have to say yes to that. Yeah. I remember when Wife Swap was at its height, and I was interviewed, and I said, of course I'd do Wife Swap. And my wife said, what the hell are you talking about? There's no way we'd do it.
Celebrity Wife Swap, though, you'd do that.
No, I don't think so. But
what kind of boss are you?
I don't know. It's very hard to be clear about what kind of boss one is. I hope I'm empowering and inspiring, but you'd have to ask people who worked with me.
Yeah, I'm sure they'd say that. So, in terms of your own inspiration, your father's commercials production company was called Studio Lambert, and I've seen a fantastic montage of images in your office for, you know, various commercials, and in fact you were in a cornflakes ad with your brothers, I think, weren't you?
We were. Actually, I was in quite a few commercials when I was growing up.
We've got a clip, not now. how influential was he in your life? And, you know, did you grow up in a very creative, ideas-rich household?
I grew up in a household where we argued a lot about ideas, and the dinner table was a place where we were forever discussing what was happening in the world and in current affairs, and that was very something I'm grateful for, because it sort of
intellectually stimulating environment.
I hope so. Yes, and also it was great. My father had a commercials production company, as you say, and he had his own studio in Soho. And that was unusual to have your own studio as a production company, but if you could keep it busy, which you did, then it meant that the economics of the business worked very well. And I learned how to, something about the process being there as a student. I remember having worked at his company in the summer holidays and watching the way in which he would take 20 or 30 takes. The first time I went filming with a BBC crew and we did one take, I couldn't believe it. What do you mean? Surely we're going to do that again. But that was interesting, I think, also with making documentaries. When I first started, I thought that everything had to be planned and worked out and shot-listed it all and be very clear about what I was going to do. And by the time I got to the end of my directing period as a documentary maker, all I was interested in was spontaneity. I just, you know, it was capturing spontaneity that was the magic. And that meant that you had to stop yourself intervening, because if you intervened, you kill things. And that's sort of what we apply to a lot of the programs we make now. I mean, something like Gogglebox, we give them an awful lot of room for spontaneity. The families that we film, they have two cameras in that room. It's effectively a sort of version of the rig show. It's not as complicated as some of the big rigs, but there are two cameras there, one getting a wide shot, one getting a moving tight shot, and there's nobody else from production in the room, and you're just trying to, if you've chosen the right people and you give them the right stimulus, then you will get some magic spontaneously. And then it's just, I mean, the huge challenge of that show is it's essentially a comedy, and a comedy is all about brilliant craft editing. It's just that we've got about 2 days to find the magic and cut it all together. So the teams making it are exceptional.
And actually that brings me on to the point about you know, casting, because getting that right is absolutely crucial to the success of Gogglebox, with, you know, some incredible characters there. And you know, how do you secure them? How do you agree, you know, who's right? How do you get them to trust you? And, you know, now it's in, what, 9th series, 10th series, that it's, you know, they're the same contributors. How do you continue to work with them keep hold of them, and you know, and their lives change massively. So there's also a kind of duty of care element, really, isn't there?
There is. A lot of questions there.
Yeah.
One of the things that we did that was interesting, I think, about Gogglebox is that we never advertised for people to be on the show. We didn't want people who wanted to be on television.
Mm. So no TV wannabes was your first rule.
No TV wannabes. We try to work out the kinds of people. When Tim had the first idea, let's do a programme about watching people watching television. I said, that's a stupid idea, it's never going to work. But actually what I did say was, so it has been done before, which is always one of the problems if you've been in television a long time. You sort of know what's been there before. There was a show when Channel 4 first started called On the Box that Jane Root and Michael Jackson made. And they had the idea of putting cameras inside televisions. Mm. And they discovered, lo and behold, that people don't watch the television in the same kind of concentration you might expect. They're making out, they're ironing, they're not there, they're eating, they're arguing, whatever. But that was very much a sociological study, and that's what initially we sort of thought maybe we were talking about. But it was realizing, no, this is actually an opportunity to create a docu-soap about an amazing collection of very diverse characters, and the television is merely providing the stimulus for them to comment on what's going on that week. And it was realizing that that's what we wanted, and then to get that range of characters and to think about who we wanted. So we thought we wanted a North London Jewish family. So our researchers went and to Golders Green and hung outside Waitrose and other shops talking to people and trying to find a great North London Jewish family like the Tappers. We wanted an intelligent retired couple from Liverpool, so our researchers went to the bridge clubs of Liverpool and found Leon and June. And that was really the approach that we did. We were using documentary techniques of finding great people and then persuading them to take part in the programme.
Are there any characters that you really want to get still that you've struggled to find?
I'm pretty happy with the range that we've got. I mean, you know, people talk about Steph and Dom as being the posh couple. I'd quite like to find a really posh couple. But you've got to find a really posh couple that are also likeable, and that's not that easy.
You've got, so, Gogglebox, you've tried to evolve the format with some success, and actually Vlogglebox didn't necessarily work as well. Have you got thoughts on evolving and, you know, knowing what works and what doesn't, and why you think surely that's a surefire hit?
Yeah, it was interesting. We launched a series on E4 this year called Vlogglebox. Maybe that was the mistake. I don't think that was the right title. It was young people watching YouTube material and all the other kinds of things that you can see on the internet and commenting, not in their homes but in different locations. It was technically very innovative because we shot the whole thing on iPhones but found ways of getting the image and the whole recording to be very high quality. Just nobody watched it.
No 45 million viewers for that, sadly.
No 45 million. I think that's partly to do with the fact it was scheduled at 9 o'clock on E4, and I think E4 is a very hard place to launch a show at 9 o'clock. We make another show for E4 called Tattoo Fixes that launched at 10 o'clock. That's much easier place to launch a show on E4 is at 10 o'clock. Once it works, then move it to 9 o'clock. Mm. But Vlogglebox was actually quite expensive, so they decided to put it at 9 o'clock, and maybe it was hubris because they thought, oh, it'll work. We spent a lot on it's a spin-off of Gogglebox, but it didn't work.
And do you have those conversations with schedulers then, you know, especially on the back of that? Would you say, no, put it at 10?
Yeah, they go, okay, whatever. And they don't really listen to you. I mean, you can try to influence it a little bit, but, you know, there are many things that the broadcasters guard jealously. One is their relationship with advertisers, and the other is their scheduling. Mm. And I can think of probably quite a few other ones, but those are the first two that come to mind.
And then you've got Undercover Boss, Gogglebox, Four in a Bed, Tattoo Fixes. You know, you're approaching your 10th anniversary with a really strong slate and, you know, obviously great reputation. Are you, you know, at where you expected to be in sort of 10 years? You know, what was your 5-year plan, and then sort of moving forward, you know, how do you want to develop now?
Well, We always wanted to be a successful company in both Britain and America, and that was the sort of challenge. We were quite bold about setting up an American office pretty much at the same time as launching the company in Britain. And then we got lucky with Undercover Boss, which sustained the business from the start in America. About 2 years ago, we were able to do a new deal with all three, and it gave us the resources to move into territories, into genres that we hadn't been in. I always wanted to have a drama division, and I was able to persuade Sue Hogg, who's a fantastic executive producer who had been at the BBC and before that at ITV, to join us. And we now have a very strong drama slate. We've had our first show, which we did in association with BBC Studios because Sue had started it at the BBC before she joined us. But it was May while she was with us, and that was Three Girls, which is a remarkable series, mini-series.
Won four awards last week at
last week at the Women in Television Awards. And we can play a quick clip of it, and we've got lots of other dramas coming down the pipeline.
Wow, incredible. So the reaction from the press and the public and, you know, awards juries is... It's been, you know, pretty unprecedented. So obviously, congratulations to Sue and her team. It sort of goes back to the duty of care question that, you know, I referred to earlier with Gogglebox. You know, in a different way, there are, you know, people there that you had to be very mindful of. So again, that sort of must take up a lot of time. How do you handle that?
Yeah, I mean, Sue and Simon, the producer. Put an enormous amount of energy into managing that relationship with the real girls, and they were. I mean, they had to bring them on board. They had to persuade them that this was worth doing. They had to tell them about what was happening. Ultimately, they had to show them the program, and everybody agreed, including the BBC, and especially the BBC, that if they didn't like it, then the program really shouldn't go out and probably wouldn't have gone out. Fortunately, they did, in fact. Some of them talked about how watching it made them realize for the first time that, you know, that they were victims in a way that they hadn't appreciated. Mm. And both Sue and Simon are still talking to them a lot now.
Right. And talking about the other projects that you want to do within drama, are you looking for more prestige docs like that? I mean, as you said, you know, with single docs, you know, they're not money spinners, but, you know, there's other reasons to do them. Are you looking at doing more mainstream, returnable dramas?
Or yes.
What's the mix?
Yes,
right.
Yes.
Okay, a big yes.
yeah, I mean, everything else we're doing, well, with one exception, is intended to be a returning drama series, and we've got several that I think are definitely happening or are very close to happening.
Right.
Whether they will return obviously depends on how popular they are.
And you're announcing those soon?
We're hoping to announce those soon. Okay. Sue actually did sneakily get something a bit in the vein of Three Girls commissioned the other day, and, you know, I'm very closely involved with her and all her slate, but she hadn't mentioned this one to me, and she called me up slightly frightened to say, "I got a commission. It's not a very valuable show." It's just but I was very positive about it. It's great.
Then, yeah.
She snuck it in as an idea.
And what about entertainment? What's happening?
Yeah, well, that's
there?
The other thing. We're very keen to move into drama, and we know that's happening. We've also brought on a. We've hired somebody who has a fantastic track record in, you know, what we call shiny floor entertainment. Worked on pretty much all the big studio shows, and we've just delivered our first pilot to the BBC, which we hope they will pick up. Unusually, they agreed to allow, because we started showing it to people at MIPCOM, to the international market, and they agreed to allow Thailand, who loved it so much, to go first, and they're already in production on the first series of 13 episodes.
Okay.
It's an interesting idea in as much as it's really a studio entertainment version of Faking It.
Mm.
And in fact, what happened was that the BBC said to us, oh, we actually did a pilot. This is, they forgot that they had done this. So they ordered the pilot from us, and then a few weeks later said, oh, we've just realized we ordered a pilot a bit like this, which we didn't pick up from RDF. Could we persuade you to work together? And in the end, we agreed. And it's been very amicable and actually rather constructive and positive. And so...
So a new lease of life for Faking It.
A new lease of life for a show that's a bit like Faking It. It's essentially the idea of people learning a skill and can people spot the novice. And that's what this show is. It's a variety act, and it turns the variety act into a game show, because there are four or five variety acts in each episode. There are always four principal performers. Sometimes there are many other performers, but there are always four main performers. One of those four is a novice who's only had 4 weeks to learn the skill. And we see a little film beforehand, a minute or two, like those little training films in Strictly. But we don't see the face of the person learning. We see their mentor, we see their mother or their friends or whatever, but we just see the point of view shots of the novice. So the first time we see the novice is when we're seeing the start of the performance, but they're standing alongside the other three professionals, and we, the TV audience and the studio audience, are having to try to work out who is the novice.
And this is called Catch Me Out?
It's called Catch Me
and
Out.
We've got
a little clip, so okay. We can play that.
Wonderful performance. Well done. This was absolutely breathtakingly good.
It just doesn't get any better than that performance.
This is Catch Me Out.
Where do I start?
I'm Dr. Jackie Bell.
My day job is working at a science museum.
Let me show you a little taster of what we do.
Oh my God.
I can never picture her doing that.
It's actually really scary.
I look dead ahead. I am Beyonce and just strut. That was terrible.
It's time to awake. Yeah, yeah. Attention, ladies. Attention, it's a bit to walk. Original, listen up. Ha! Let me hear you say. Ladies all across the world, listen up. We're looking for a crowd. If you're with me, let me see your hands. Sit up and salute. Get your killer heels, sneakers, pulse. All these fucking boots. Representing all the women. Salute.
Our novice. Red. Green. Blue. Or yellow. It's time to reveal which of our flaming hot fire girls is Jackie. It's Jackie, everyone! It was amazing. Winner is... It's Jackie! Make your decision now!
Great. Actually, I wish we hadn't revealed that. We could have had a great Christmas quiz, couldn't we? Like, which is Jackie? And so, in fact, a few of us played it in your office and we were all wrong, weren't we? It's yellow, it's definitely yellow. Anyway, I love that. I think that looks fantastic. So it's being shown in Thailand and will...
Be made in Thailand.
Being made in Thailand, sorry.
Hopefully it will be made here. We just need the BBC to get on with making a decision.
Right. So hopefully,
so if anybody likes it, write to Charlotte Moore or Kate Phillips.
anything else entertainment-wise you can reveal? You've got some other things.
Well, we've got lots of other ideas in the pipeline. In fact, we've got two very big reality shows that I think are going to happen that we should be able to announce early in the new year.
Right.
They're not studio entertainment shows, but they are. I mean, we've been concentrating this year more than ever in trying to aim for the really big shows, which are, in a funny way, there's less competition for them, in the sense that there are lots and lots of independent production companies. They tend, on the whole, to concentrate more on trying to get the four-part factual series or the... I don't know, all kinds of shows, but those really monster shows, the idols or the talents or the Big Brothers or whatever, there aren't that many people pitching those kinds of ideas because they're very difficult to get to persuade a broadcaster to go with them. They're big gambles for them. So most of the time, if you started to sort of develop something like that, you might not succeed, and you put an awful lot of effort into it. It takes a long time to persuade them to go with those kinds of really big shows. And so although it's a big effort, and although it's a big risk in the sense that these two that I'm talking about, we've spent at least 6 months, if not more, working on them. And if they don't happen, that's, you know, you're basically putting fewer chips on the table but bigger stakes, and it's a strategic decision that we decided to make. But hopefully it'll pay off.
Yes, but kind of high risk as well.
Exactly. So
the new boss at Channel 4, Ian Katz. Do we think he's going to take a risk on these huge scale hits at this point, or is he going to devolve that to his commission team? What's your view on what's ahead at Channel 4?
Well, it's interesting that the Channel 4 has decided to change with a new chief executive and now incoming in as director of programmes. I know, talking to Alex, that she thinks that it would be better if the channel was less centralised than it's been. And I think that, if anything, the sort of theme of what I've been talking about is that balance between delegated commissioning power or the sort of opening up of the sort of who makes the decisions in terms of the creative kind of capital. And we've gone from a situation where I think there was more of that spread around when I started in television, to a point now where it tends to be very, very few people, usually one person. I mean, in the case of the BBC, essentially one person doing all the channels. I mean, Charlotte is across BBC One, BBC Two, and BBC Four. I mean, it's an extraordinary concentration of power. And I think that it's good that that Channel 4 is going to have to give more power to its commissioning heads, its genre heads, the people who run the different departments in the channel. Because Ian, who I actually know, is a very bright, very clever guy, and very inspiring. I think he'd be very good at making sure that the programmes that they commission have a real Channel 4 sensibility. But you know, he's not steeped in broadcast television. He's come from print and has spent the last few years editing Newsnight. But it's a huge leap, and I think it's a good thing, because I think it will lead to a change in the culture at Channel 4, but it means that the commissioning people will have to be more confident about what it is that they want to do, and and persuade him to do it, I think we'll inevitably be given more autonomy to back the things that they believe in.
Mm-hmm. So good news for the indie sector.
Well, we'll see. I think it potentially is.
Yeah, great. We've got time for a few questions. Has anyone got any questions for Stephen? And gentleman on the front row, thank you.
Hey, Stephen. Great fan of your work, by the way, so really great to hear you speak. I'm an independent consultant focusing on digital and new media strategy within entertainment. So with that, my question is, with digital dominating many conversations of how best to use it and serve objectives such as goals of reaching new audiences, I'm curious to know how you're thinking about the media when developing new shows and coming up with creative concepts.
Okay, well, partly depends on what you mean by digital, because if you're talking about Netflix and Amazon and Apple, the new buyers, that's sort of different to thinking about, I don't know, digital in the sense of short pieces for YouTube or whatever, although obviously YouTube are getting into the same kind of business as Amazon and Netflix with YouTube Red as a subscription service.
So broadly talking about those players, but then also thinking about social media and how you bake that into the creative concepts that potentially you're thinking about using digital talent as a form of also reaching new audiences and how that works.
Yes, well, I mean, lots of people are trying to find ways of bringing digital talent in the sense of YouTube stars onto mainstream television. It's both in Britain and America. It's proved tougher than people thought. You'd think that if you've got millions of followers on YouTube and you take part in a mainstream television program, that millions of people are going to watch that program. It hasn't actually happened, maybe because the millions that watch those people on YouTube don't watch conventional television. That's not to say that there aren't some people who are very talented that, if they want to, can successfully make the transformation to, or the transfer to conventional television. Very often they don't want to because actually they're doing very well on YouTube. It can be extremely lucrative if you've got the right business on YouTube. And conventional television doesn't necessarily help or match that.
So do you have any ideas in development with any YouTube stars at the moment?
We're making a celebrity undercover boss with a YouTube star, mm-hmm. One of the episodes.
Right. So
we'll see. I mean, we're certainly developing a lot. Well, in drama, we're making stuff for some of those big new streaming companies. Mm-hmm. We haven't got anything away in unscripted yet with them, but it's difficult, actually, because the streamers are both great in the sense that they're new buyers and they've got lots of money. It's less attractive in as much as they take global rights. And, you know, our model has been to create shows that often here, sometimes in America, where we can, if they're successful, sell them all over the world. Mm-hmm. If you make a show for Netflix, you don't sell it all over the world because they take the world. Mm-hmm. When they first started, they said, well, yes, we do, but we're going to give you a 30% premium to compensate for that. And we're going to be very hands-off, we'll give you a lot of creative freedom. I get the sense that that's changing now,
yeah,
that they're a little bit less hands-off and the premium is falling a bit.
Yeah.
So it could easily get to the point where
we're turning
those global streamers will struggle to be as attractive. I mean, in the end of the day, they're still buyers and you obviously can have a very successful business that isn't about selling the format or selling the tape around the world, but it's just the production business of making it and you spend less on making the show than they give you, so there's a profit. But it does fight a bit with the sort of normal model.
The model here, yeah. And I think there's a question just behind as well.
Thank you. So a slightly more light-hearted question for you. You were talking about faking it earlier on. I never had the opportunity to see it start off with until I worked with Spence Bowdler. He was the gunrunner who turned drag queen. And of course, then I scuttled off home and tried to watch as many as possible. And he was a lovely bloke, and I really enjoyed it. And it just turned me, and it obviously got me looking at the show. So I was just wondering, as a light-hearted question, which was your favorite of those contestants?
My favorite? Well, there were lots of good. Spencer was
was an excellent character. I mean, more that I there were some favourites that I didn't realise how big they could be. I mean, in those days, I still was rather focused on the one-off programme. This was my first repeating show. We had this guy who we did a show about what we called a burger flipper, somebody doing fast food, trying to fake it as a top chef. And he had this mentor called, I think his name was Gordon Ramsay. and he seemed pretty good, but I didn't think maybe we could do more shows with Gordon Ramsay. That was a mistake. And there were a few others that went on to have very successful television careers that we failed to spot. But there were many of them that were great. What I loved about that show was the way in which they took on this challenge. Often it was a challenge that they didn't have a particular desire to take on, but they were persuaded to do it, and their mentors were amazing. One of the things that was so amazing about the mentors was that they agreed to let these people come and live in their own homes. And so they formed this incredibly strong bond. And by the end of the month, they really cared. The faker didn't want to let down the mentor. The mentor wanted the faker to succeed. And it has such heart. People love that show.
Do we have any other questions?
Hello, I'm Alex from Broadcast. I was just wondering, as you clearly have big ambitions for the business and as you look ahead over the next 5-10 years, really what you see as the challenges facing the industry and your company, how you anticipate the industry evolving. I mean, you've touched on the SVOD streamers, you're talking about expanding breadth of genres. I'm just wondering what you really see as the main challenges that you are going to have to grapple with as you grow and expand over the next medium-term period.
Well, the number one challenge is the same challenge you've always had, which is coming up with ideas that people want to buy. But that's kind of timeless. But not to be underrated as a problem.
For the industry, you know.
Sure, the changing shape of the industry. Well, it doesn't feel like it's a bad time to be a producer. There are more buyers than ever. And that's very exciting. And we launched our drama department, division, whatever, 2 years ago, and at least half the shows that we're making are for American customers, and that's something, but they're going to be shot in Britain. Now, that's a huge change. I mean, a few years ago, if you were a drama department company in the UK, you were essentially making shows for British television, which in reality meant that 95% of the time you were making a show for BBC One or ITV, because they commissioned the vast majority of all the drama. And if you didn't have a show that those two buyers wanted, you weren't getting anywhere. Now it feels like there is a lot more opportunity, and people will, Americans in particular, will buy shows and put real money into something that's not set in America. And that's a big change. I mean, we're doing a show for a fairly big American cable network, and we suggested that it was set in Berlin because it worked for our team and for the writer, and I thought, oh, they'll never go for it, but they loved it, and that wouldn't be what I would have expected a few years ago. But that's not really answering your questions. I think the real pressure is that whole rights position thing, and I think there's a lot of pressure on the buyers to grow their vertical, their own production businesses. You see this a lot in the broadcast companies in America. I mean, if you're making a show for NBC, certainly in unscripted these days, you pretty much have to do a co-production with their own in-house production people. CBS has started up doing in-house production in unscripted. The networks buy, in terms of drama, increasingly from their own studios. So that feels like the sort of one of the trends in America. I think here, thankfully, Channel 4 is still very committed not to having in-house. I think the BBC getting rid of its commitment, to, you know, the guarantee to in-house, to what is now BBC Studios, is a absolutely well overdue decision. I mean, the idea that you're spending half the program budget on one supplier, regardless of the quality of their ideas, was a crazy idea. I think that in-house well, studios will struggle to maintain the share of the spend that it's had in the past, that it was guaranteed in the past. I think ITV has grown its production enormously, mainly through acquisition. I think I'd be surprised that they carry on with that as a strategy. I don't see how they can keep making production work for them. And I think actually they did some deals that might turn out to be, in retrospect, a bit questionable, particularly in America, in terms of how much they paid for companies that are now not doing as well as when they bought them.
But in terms of being a producer,
it's an exciting time. Yeah. There are more opportunities than ever before.
Mm. So I think that's a fantastically optimistic note to end on for this Christmas conversation. So I'd like you all to join me in thanking Stephen. Thank you very much.
My name is Terry Marsh from the London Committee. My role to offer a formal vote of thanks to you, and it's my role to perhaps reflect on some of the things we learnt from tonight. We've just learnt that vertical integration in the US means you often have to co-pro with the in-house people. But one of the key ones was if you were going to have a new show, launch it after the Super Bowl, which was a good one. If you intervene, you kill, which I think is actually really quite a big mantra, isn't it, when you think about that, especially in terms of you're talking about the Channel 4 opening up of creative decisions being an exciting opportunity, you know. You've had a journey. The J word applies, from cornflakes to being an empowering and inspiring boss, that was your words. But I wondered whether you ever imagined when you were working in the secretariat of the BBC that you would eventually set BBC management against the governors and pull everybody out on strike. In the US, it's rude if you don't expose yourself and your ideas to everyone. If you hang about outside Waitrose, you might get some good casting done. Which another interesting thing is there's less competition for the monster shows, but the big risks are entailed. The lovely last thing that you were saying, there are more buyers than ever. Your wife has been very important to your career. She inspired Faking It and also the creation of Studio Lambert, but she's having nothing to do with wife swap, is she? And I just want to end up on two words which really struck a chord with me. You referred to your programmes as having such heart, and actually you have such heart. So thank you very much. And we have a small presentation to make, and will you all join us, please, in the bar afterwards, which is now open. Thank you very much.